Welcome to our first panel of the day, discussing the greatest national security challenge facing the next president. Please welcome your moderator, national security analyst, KT McFarland.
To CPAC 2016, and I'm so excited to be the first panel in what is the most important CPAC convention since 1980. Were any of you here in 1980? Oh, I guess I'm the only one. Why is it the most important? Because this is a time of great decision, the conservative movement and the Republican Party. You're going to make that decision. And the people you're going to meet and hear and listen to today, tomorrow, and the next day are the ones who are going to lead that revolution. You have to decide which ones to pick and what issues are important. So I'm very honored to have a distinguished and diverse group of people with different backgrounds. Congressman Ryan Zinke, he is a former Navy SEAL. And the Republican representative-at-large from Montana, Deneen Borelli. She is the chief political correspondent of Conservative Review and a colleague of mine at Fox News from New York. Yeah. Welcome, Deneen.
Thank you.
And Jim Carafano, vice president of the Heritage Foundation. And I said that we were a diverse group. He's here to represent the Army because he's an Army veteran.
Beat Army.
Definitely beat Army. I'm a Navy mom, so that's me. The reason this is so exciting and important, a CPAC, is that when Ronald Reagan came here in 1980, we were in a very similar place in the nation. The economy wasn't working right. We were getting pushed around all over the world. We had lost our sense of self as a nation. And the country, really, if you take it a public opinion poll, the public opinion poll said that the majority of the American people thought our time was done. That we used to be a great nation, but we no longer were. Reagan came in to CPAC, and he said, I challenge that. I challenge the Republican establishment, and I challenge the Democrats, and here's the vision I lay out, and here's what I think is important. He said, we gotta fix the economy. He said, we've got to reassert America's leadership role in the world, and we've got to restore a sense of who we are. I know because I was there. I was a member of the Reagan Revolution. Yeah, go.
As a child.
And but I wasn't a White House intern, Ryan. but when I went into the Pentagon in the beginning of the Reagan administration, President Reagan's theme was peace through strength. Now, what did that mean? It sounds like a throwaway line, right? What politician is against peace through strength? I mean, you're not for peace? You don't want to be strong? So it sounds like, gee, I'm for peace for strength. But Reagan thought very deliberately and for a long time about what that meant. And he chose those words very carefully. For Reagan, peace wasn't just the absence of war. And it wasn't the peace that comes from capitulation, as the current version of peace is. And it wasn't the peace that comes from conquest. And it wasn't just peaceful coexistence. And when Reagan talked about strength, he just didn't mean the strength of our armed forces and our military. He meant the strength of our economy, of our system of government, of our representative democracy, and all of the elements of national power that add to our strength. But what he was most interested in peace through strength, was his first step was to rebuild the United States military. When we went into the Pentagon in the beginning of the Reagan administration, we were horrified by what we saw. After a decade of neglect of our armed forces, we had ships that couldn't sail because they didn't have fuel. We had airplanes that we couldn't fly because the pilots for those airplanes didn't have enough training hours to qualify. And for every tank we had that worked, there was one sitting right next to it that was cannibalized for spare parts. All that was terrible. But what was most horrible that we saw at the beginning of the Reagan administration is the way the previous administrations, Republicans and Democrats, had treated our veterans. That our veterans did not have the adequate health care, mental health care, physical health care, and we paid them so little that our most junior enlisted personnel qualified for food stamps. Well, Reagan turned all that around. He rebuilt the American military, and he challenged the Soviet Union. He said, "My policy towards the Soviet Union is simple. We win, they lose." But when Reagan took office, that was a fairy tale fantasy, because the United States wasn't economically strong, wasn't militarily strong, and we were not strong as in our sense of national purpose. So Reagan turned it all around. He fixed the economy. He rebuilt that shattered military, and he targeted our main enemy's major vulnerability. He said the greatest security threat that the United States faced in the early 1980s was the Soviet Union and nuclear weapons. So how did he challenge the Soviet Union? He looked at their greatest vulnerability, which was their economy, and that's where he targeted. We rebuilt American defenses, and then Reagan understood that without high oil prices, the Soviet Union in 1980 didn't make anything the world wanted. They didn't make cars, they didn't make computers, they made nothing. The only thing they sold to the world was their oil. Reagan targeted that oil, went from $40 a barrel to $18 a barrel in 9 months. They were bankrupt. And then Reagan challenged them to a Star Wars missile defense system. At that point, the Soviet Union collapsed. And then Reagan handed the hand of friendship over to the Soviet Union and did arms control, arms reduction negotiations with them. So Reagan turned it all around in 1980 because he started right here. Here we are again, the economy's lousy, we're getting pushed around all over the world by the same people, and we've lost our sense of self. So we are going to ask these three distinguished Americans what they see as the greatest threat to America's national security. Okay, you're a war veteran, you look around the world, what do you think is our greatest threat?
Well, first, if Jimmy Carter gave us Ronald Reagan, can you imagine what President Obama is going to give us?
Woohoo!
I sit in the House Armed Services, I'm a former SEAL commander, and what I see is this. First of all, it's fixable. There isn't a problem I've seen in Congress in the year I've been sitting in the seat that isn't fixable as far as a country, as long as we lead. But what I see is we're in retreat. And as we retreat across the globe, vacuums are being formed. And those vacuums are being filled. In the case of South China Sea, China is building islands, and we are retreating. And our neighbors in there and our traditional allies view that as a weakness. And China is expanding their influence and territory in the South China Sea. Then you do a pivot to Ukraine, Russia, we're abandoning our treaty obligations, and Russia is emboldened. They're putting flags in the North Pole. They're continuing to move. And finally, you look at what's happened in the Middle East, where you have a rise of Iran looking at recreating Persia, and aided by, of course, Russia. And then, of course, you look at the context of the Iranian nuclear deal and the damage that has done. Not only the billions of dollars that have been spent and will be spent shoring up organizations like Hezbollah and Hamas, but also what people need to understand is it gave a legal framework for Iran to acquire as many as 100 nuclear-tipped ICBMs in 13 short years. So how did that occur? Well, in 5 years, the sanctions on the conventional weapons get lifted. And remember, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Dempsey, said in no circumstance do we give Iran advanced missile technology. In 5 years, we do that. In 8 years, we give them the ability to launch ICBMs. There's only one purpose for an ICBM. That's to arm. In 10 years, the centrifuges that were supposed to be dismantled come out of storage, never dismantled. They get enhanced. And so in 13 years, they could have as many as 100 nuclear-tipped missiles pointed at the United States. And believe me, that is not in our best interest. And I'll go back to John F. Kennedy. What we see is our enemies don't fear us and our allies don't trust us. And John F. Kennedy's inaugural address said, "We as a nation would bear any price and pay any burden in the defense of liberty." I can tell you that's a rallying call for our allies, because they always knew that in time of need, America would stand, that we would be a reliable ally you could count on. And this is what retreat has done. So the greatest threat that I see in national security is ourselves, because we as a great country also bear a great responsibility. Doesn't mean we have to be the policemen of the world, but certainly we have to be that reliable ally and show strength and lead from the front. And when we don't, it has a consequence. And that consequence is felt in refugees, 3.5 million. And if we don't lead, that refugee crisis of 3.5 million in Syria will spread across the Middle East, it'll spread into Africa, and we'll have a refugee crisis on, comparable to World War II. It is absolutely fixable, but under this administration, there is not a chance.
Well, that's pretty grim, but very realistic. I'm going to come back to you and ask you what do we do next, but you think about that. I'm going to now turn to Deneen Borelli, who's been an outspoken critic in sort of the state of, well, of America's moral character and health.
Sure.
What do you think our greatest threat is?
Well, I realize this is about national security, and my focus really is on the security within the United States of America and the threat that is posed there. And I have two quotes that I want to read really quickly. One by Abraham Lincoln: "America will never be destroyed from the outside. If we falter and lose our freedoms, it will be because we destroyed ourselves." That's President Abraham Lincoln. President Ronald Reagan, the whole theme of this panel today, a quote from Reagan: "Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on for them to do the same. Or one day we will spend our sunset years telling our children and our children's children what it was once like in the United States where we were free." That was Ronald Reagan. Today, my friends, yeah. So here we are in 2016, and what we are witnessing is an onslaught of massive growth of government. And under President Obama, I believe he has done more harm than good when it comes to his leadership for our country. And I look at the fact that when you look at the GDP, under 3% under his watch, unemployment is through the roof, our debt is over 90 trillion, million, counting, the numbers don't even make sense anymore, over 90 trillion. Individuals who are on government assistance. His energy policy is harming hardworking Americans. I'm looking at this also as a threat to our country, claiming that he's helping the environment when in fact it's a command and control energy policy, doing more harm than good, especially for those who are unable to afford energy at the higher cost because of regulations. But not only that, the regulations are putting fossil fuel industry businesses out of business, bankrupting coal companies. There are thousands of coal miners who are out of work. Look at what is happening in West Virginia, states where coal is mined. These communities are being decimated. So these are economic issues that are harming our country from the inside out. There's also the politically correct aspect of what is harmful to our country. Political correctness kills. And it's sad because the most recent example is what happened in San Bernardino, California. You had these two terrorist individuals, and there was a neighbor who saw all this activity going on, and she was afraid of being called a racist. That is why she didn't come forward. political correctness kills. The other PC, race card. I don't know about you, but I am tired of hearing about the race card being played constantly. Constantly. The progressive played the race card to cover for their failures. They have all the bases covered. I'm black. I am critical to anyone who is harming our country because of the massive growth of government and rules and regulations. And I also criticize President Obama. I wouldn't care what color his skin color is. He is doing a disservice to our country by harming hardworking Americans, and he has been inclusive in this race card baiting that is happening. And so to summarize, the PC culture and Obama's leadership, lack of leadership, are harming our country from within. And we look at the outsiders who want to do harm to our country because of the greatness of America. I always say America is an exceptional country, no matter where I go. And it is. And it is up to us to make sure it remains that exceptional country. Thank you.
All right, Dr. Carafano, two really hard acts to follow. What do you think our national security threats are?
Well, first of all, this is exciting. This is more people than I've ever met in my life. Really, I am so excited to be here because I get to be here with three amazing people. This is the congressman that cares. If there is a vote or a debate in Congress about, is this going to keep the nation free, safe, and prosperous, and the answer is yes, that is the first hand up. And if the answer is no, that is the first fist down. This is a great American. We're lucky to have him there. And these are two very powerful voices. These are the people that drive the left loony. I mean, they're clear, they're concise, they're confident, they have common sense, and they're conservative. So thank you for what you guys do. It's amazing. I'm the sad sack on the panel. I just get to talk about things that are bad. I call my mother every week, and she says, don't tell me what you did today. I mean, I'll try to be really quick. So, part of people say, look, we hear all the bad things that Ryan is talking about, but look, they're not going to attack the United States. I mean, they're not idiots. And I would agree with you to an extent. The goal of almost every one of America's enemies in the world, whether it's a state or a non-state actor, is to win without fighting, right? Their idea is to find the conditions, to create them, to find the gap or exploit the opportunity, to find a way where America will say, that's not our problem, we can't do that, that's too hard, that's too dangerous, to incrementally walk us away. And that can lead to a very dangerous place. And why that's so bad is because the policies of this administration are tailor-made to be exploited by that. So let me give you four examples just real quickly. Nuclear weapons, right? Like, North Korea's got nuclear weapons. North Korea doesn't want to have a nuclear war with the United States. Of course they don't. But here's what they do want. We talked about this prophetically in our documentary that we did a few years ago called 33 Minutes. It's to hold America hostage. All I have to do is to demonstrate that if we are going to have a tussle, you could lose a city or more. And America, are you willing to make that debate? So what are the things that really do that? We have a long-range nuclear weapon, and then you have a thermonuclear weapon that's a city killer, or you have the ability to field, detonate a weapon in space and create an EMP effect that destroys your entire electrical grid and takes out your economy. North Korea has both those capabilities, and that is a growth industry. They are a marketing campaign and a Walmart waiting to happen. And unless we do something different, the greatest threat in your lives, this will be the age of nuclear proliferation, where not just them, but every state and non-state threat expands into that field. Cyber. Here's one of the things the next president's going to face. Putin wants to find an opportunity to demonstrate that NATO is just a paper shell and won't really meet its defense commitments, right? He doesn't want to start World War III. He's going to find a way to poke us and hope we just crack, right? And cyber is a good way to do that. Russia is one of the premier evil cyber actors in the world today. But other people are watching and will emulate what they do. And other people could create the capability to create situations where they hurt us and we're fearful to act. I'll give you another example, terrorism. Right. ISIS and Al-Qaeda, what makes them a great threat today is not that they have a state in the Middle East, but they have used those opportunities to create networks that are stretching around the world. And I've just been all over South Asia. I've talked to people in Malaysia, Indonesia, and other countries. I've talked to people in the Middle East, a lot of Europeans. Everybody is fearful of the same thing. These networks are out there, and they're going to be used to come after us without ISIS having to do this themselves. And this is the breaking news that the next president's going to face. Let's say even we push ISIS down. We have so allowed Al-Qaeda in the last 8 years to get back in the game that Al-Qaeda will just stand up its flag and the forces will rally around them. This is a generational challenge that's not going away. And the last one real quickly is the economy, right? China's probably the best example of that. One of the greatest self-restraints that we have, not just us, but our allies, is, well, we can't mess with China because we do business with them. It'll hurt our business. And the Chinese like that thinking. They like that talk. But it's absolutely not true. If we don't defend and protect our security interests, they're not going to be nice to us. And how can we push back economically? Well, you have to really look at what's the great driver, and it's economic freedom, not just opening up your own economy, but those are your friends and your allies. So one of the things we produce is an index of economic freedom. Under President Obama, our level of economic freedom in America has fallen every year. We're not in the top 10. We're not even a free economy anymore. So unleashing our economy at home and a foreign policy that helps unleash those of our friends and allies abroad is absolutely crucial. And then the problem is, just to sum up, is Obama's foreign policy of the last 8 years is really revisiting the 90s. How did we get here? You know, under President Clinton, we withdrew from the world. And bin Laden wrote his really famous fatwa. And he said, look, America has become a paper tiger. If we push them, they will fall. And that's what directly to 9/11. And what we're doing now is really recreating all the withdrawal that we did in the 90s. So another index that we produce is the index of US military strength, where we grade America's capacity to defend itself against the threats in the world that we face that threaten our vital national interests. Our grade is marginal. We spend $600 billion a year, and the most your president can deliver to you is marginal. And here's, I think, the consequential choice. I think that regardless of who the Democratic nominee is, you're going to get more of the same, more continuity than change. You're going to get more withdrawal from the world and more of a principle of weakness. But I really believe when you look that this, that conservatives will put forth a candidate that believes in peace through strength. Regardless of the candidate you pick, I believe the candidate that this country fields will be peace through strength, and that conservatives will lead the fight to keep America free, safe, and prosperous. I really believe that. It's an election of consequence.
Thank you. Okay, Congressman Zinke, you teased us a little bit. You articulated what the problems are, but you didn't offer too many solutions. So how? But you did say they were fixable.
Absolutely.
So how would you? Well, how would you fix everything you've talked about as a problem?
Well, one quick on the cybersecurity. I don't know why we asked the State Department for Hillary's emails. We should have just asked Putin.
Right.
Oh yeah.
But here's the Middle East. Is before we put troops on the ground, and I think it will take American troops with our allies. But you got to make sure our troops are well-led, they have the right equipment, the right training, and right rules of engagement to win. And there's a lot of frustration in the troops right now that they don't have the ability to win because the rules of engagement are tight. And we didn't learn anything in Vietnam because we're right back and probably worse. So I do think it'll take troops on the ground, probably in northern Syria. But it has to be with our allies, too, because the war is not just about East and West. It's not just about us against ISIS. It's as much as a war within Islam as it is East and West. And we have to do our part asymmetrically to look at defeating of ISIS and these Islamic terrorist organizations. And it's not that hard to say. Islamic terrorist organizations. It's not. But it will take asymmetrical warfare, and that we have to convince the Muslim world that it is as much a threat to them as it is to the West. More Muslims are getting killed than Christians. But it will take a force, it will take our allies, and you have to put a force in there that will move the needle. If 50 SEALs or special operations are launched You know, if they can fix that, that's not much of a problem. So you need to put a big enough force in there, we'll move the needle, protect our force, make sure we have medevac, QRF and those things, and we can do that and will. Last point is, when we do that, and I think the next president will have to, we have to make sure that as we push ISIS out and create a vacuum, that vacuum isn't filled by Iranian-backed forces. Because what we don't want is we don't want an emboldened Iran in Persia of expanding territory. That is fixable under a president that understands peace can only be obtained through strength.
Excellent. Let me ask you, now you both articulated a number of big ticket items that the United States might have to deal with. You talked about nuclear proliferation. Well, I guess the answer is missile defense. Cyber, that is a major economic issue as well as a security issue. Terrorism, you've talked about maybe the United States has to get militarily involved in the Middle East. And we've all talked about the economy. So if Admiral Mullen, former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, several years ago was at a congressional committee hearing, I don't think it was your committee, was it?
No.
Okay.
But I know what he said.
But he said, when asked, what do you think the greatest national security threat facing the United States is? He said, not what everybody thought he was going to say. They thought he was going to say radical Islam, or the Russians, or the Chinese, or the North Koreans. He said, no, it's the United States economy and the deficit. So how do you guys square that circle? Is our economy a major stumbling block or a potential advantage for us, and how do you do all the big ticket items you've just talked about doing?
So go back to the 1990s, where essentially what we're doing today is mimicking the policies of the 1990s. And here's the difference. In the 1990s, actually, our economy wasn't growing too bad, right? Mm-hmm. And but we didn't have a restive Russia, we didn't have a rising China, we didn't have a Middle East that was in meltdown, right? So obviously the policies of today are the policies of the 90s are inappropriate today, right? So the challenge is pretty daunting when you say, look, we have to be concerned about Western Europe. And we'll see the worst year in Western Europe that we've ever seen. We'll see Western Europe bordering on chaos this year. The Middle East is the worst it's been since the 1970s. And the rise of China is of concern to everybody in Asia and ought to be concerned to us. Those are pretty daunting challenges, and you have to do all three, right? Because all three impinge on vital US interests. That requires a better, stronger, more capable military than we have now. The facts just speak to that. It's just inarguable. And then you ask, well, where does that money come from, right? So the answer is, you get the kids around the dinner table, right? And the dad comes in and says, things aren't looking good here. We got to cut back a little. And the kids go, well, just cut the mortgage, dad, because we're not going to stop getting Netflix and look, you got to put first things first, right? So I think we can grow this economy. I think we can shrink government spending, and I think we can unleash the economy, but we have to have sensible economic policies, right? So we spend, military spending isn't even close to the top of the list we spend money on. We spend half the budget on entitlement spending. We spend more money in this country. If you add up all the welfare programs, we spend more money on that than we do on the military. So we have to get our spending priorities right, and we have to unleash the economy. Yeah. But crippling defense isn't going to make us safe, and it's not going to fix the economy.
And I would say this is you have tax, you have cut, and you have grow. I don't think we can be taxed anymore. I think you can trim the Department of Defense. We're heavy on the headquarters, let me tell you. We have 800,000 DOD employees, yep. Somewhere between 1.2 and 1.6 million contractors. Yep. So the headquarters, there's more four-star staffs than ever before. So it's like an ice cream cone, by the time you get down to actually troops fighting. So we do need to sharpen the teeth, loosen the tail. But the way out of this, folks, is we're gonna grow our economy. But in order to grow our economy, we gotta get the government out of the way.
Right. Yeah. Woo-hoo. I always think about American politics as like the GPS machine on my car. When I'm lost, which my sweet husband will tell you is often, the GPS voice doesn't come out and say, okay, KT, let's go back to where we started and do this all over again. It reroutes me. It takes me to places I may not have ever thought I'd go to. But I eventually, if I follow the voice of reason, get to where I'm going. We are now as you have said many times before on Fox News and elsewhere, we're one of the most divided places we've ever been, whether it's political correctness, whether it's the race card, whether it's over economic justice and freedom. How do you reroute us?
Well, listen, and some of that has been mentioned already. We have to do something with our tax structure, our tax code. You basically have to be an accountant to figure out your own personal tax returns. I spend hours putting our paperwork together for my husband and I. We have to do something with the tax structure. Perhaps look at a flat tax so that everyone has skin in the game. I do think another way to do the reroute, as you say, our energy, our natural resources. We need to unleash our natural resources. And to tie in with the threat with America, I think our energy grid needs to be looked at very closely, because when you look at the energy that's coming offline in different regions of the country, we could be faced with brownouts and blackouts. And again, this is something that's happening from within. If that can happen because of the regulations that are going on in our country, think about what those outside of the United States who want to harm us, that is one way that they could do harm to our country, by taking down our energy grid system. So that is something that really needs to be looked at. And again, it's the harmful regulations that are causing these coal power plants to come offline, and we're vulnerable.
Okay, final thoughts from everybody. Congressman Zinke? Yep.
Believe it or not, I'm an optimist.
Really?
The next president is going to inherit three things. It's going to inherit the most powerful military that's ever been assembled in the history of mankind. And this president can't disassemble it fast enough for that not to be true. Secondly, our energy. I'm a former geologist. We have in this country an energy potential that is superior to any other country in any other region. And yes, God loves coal, and God loves those who love coal. And lastly, is that the next president is going to have America, and we're a great people. And if we get government out of the way, where Americans can do what we do best, innovate, think out of the box, there is not a country in the world that can compete with the United States. Never. So I'm an optimist.
Yeah. Deneen Borelli?
I'm very hopeful as well, because I'm looking at all of the faces of patriots out here who are concerned about the direction our country is going in. And I meet patriots from around the country of all ages, all backgrounds, who come out on a work night because they want to know what they can do to turn our country around. And so I'm very hopeful, and I will continue to speak out on what folks can do and how everyone really does have a role to play to keep America the exceptional country that it is. Thanks.
Bring us home, Doctor.
Yeah, so I'm the pessimist, right? Yeah. Like, so there's a difference between saying it's fixable and fixing it. There is an opportunity to fix this. There is a shrinking window to turn things around. I'll go back to what I said before. This is an election of consequence. I believe there are people in this race that believe in peace through strength. I believe we can have bright days ahead, but we're at a turning point. And if we turn wrong, we're gonna wind up in a bad place.
I'm gonna finish by thanking you, but reminding you, Ronald Reagan came here in 1980, and he said, let's make America great again. He came here a year later as President Reagan, and he said, our time is now. Well, you've heard it from the best there is. Our time is now. It's fixable. We did it before. We just have to do it again. And when we did it before, as the congressman said, it was Jimmy Carter who got us into the mess. We know who Jimmy Carter is today, and he's at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue for another 8 or 9 months. The question is, where is Ronald Reagan? And that's why you are here today, to find him or her, and that's your job. We've told you the problems. You're going to find the solutions. Thank you so much for joining us.